dollar dollar bill, yo.
Alrighty, we have a good few folks in here. I think we can go ahead and get started. So, welcome, welcome in. We want to know who's in the room. So feel free to share your name, the organization you're in, what pronouns and what lands you're on. And we'll go ahead and highlight some of those as we see them popping up in the chat. I see a question asking how long this is gonna be. It will be an hour and a half. So I'm on Pacific time right now, so it'll be till 11:30 Pacific. All right, I'm seeing we got Craig with Cleveland Owns on Erie Lands. How's it going? We got Nao Shin, she, her from Sunrise Movement. Welcome in. Lots of folks coming in. Oh, this is awesome. How's it going, Gab from Resourcing Refugee Leadership Initiative? Hi, Candace from Shareable. Glad you can make it. Hope the Library of Things launch today went well. So as folks keep putting in their intros in the chat, I'll go ahead and introduce myself. My name is Samara. I use they, she pronouns, and I'm currently calling from Ohlone Lands, and I'm with New Economy Coalition. So I do the tech support, the IT operations, all of that good stuff over here. So just letting you all know a few things. If you want to enable closed captioning, there are some automatic Zoom enabled captions that you can turn on. It should be under a captions button or a live transcript button. And these chat transcriptions are, you know, always gonna be automatically generated. They're not always gonna be perfect. So if you need clarification, feel free to send a message in the chat asking for that. If you need any kind of tech support, do hit me up in the chat or message any of my other fellow hosts, and we'll try and get your needs worked out. And just one last thing is that a recording of today's webinar is going to be shared with everybody who registered. So if you have to leave early, we'll be sure to share the recording afterwards so you can see the rest of the juicy bits. So NEC is super excited to host this event. Here's a little bit about our organization. So the New Economy Coalition, we're a membership-based network representing the solidarity economy in the US. So we have a network of members, around 100, 150 members who help support the solidarity economy movement. And we support those members through trainings and gatherings, narrative building, and practicing collective governance of our resources. So what is the solidarity economy? The solidarity economy movement is many things. So it's not just a global movement that is rooted in participatory democracy, mutual aid, repair, respect for the earth, all of these principles. It is also a set of values, practices, and institutions that provide real alternatives to capitalism, to racial capitalism. And it is also an economic system where all of the things a community needs are controlled and governed by everyday people. So what to expect today? First, I'm gonna pass it to Nairuti and Zach. They're gonna give some context and framing of today's webinar. Then Nairuti and Brel will walk us through the launch of the Solidarity Economy Funding Library, going over some resourcing agreements as well. After that, Suparna and our great panelists are going to go into a storytelling section where we're going to hear some stories from different organizations across the SE movement and the learnings that we can take from that. And then we're going to close and leave y'all with some calls to action. So let's get started. I'm now going to pass it to Naruti and Zach, who I will spotlight
Great.
real quick.
Thank you so much, Samara. And wow, welcome everyone. I'm seeing there are about 520 people in this space and counting, and the numbers are ticking up. Thank you so much for joining and landing in this space today. So my name is Nairuthi. I'm using she/her pronouns today. And I'm calling in from unceded Peoria territory, which is colonially known as Northwestern Indiana. I'm repping my South Bend t-shirt for today's event. So over the past few months, I've been serving as the project manager for this funding library, supporting NEC and kind of making their dreams of opening the black box of funding into a reality. And I'm joined by Zach.
Thanks, Narity. Hey, everybody. I'm Zach. I'm using he and him pronouns today. I'm the Resource Mobilization Director over here at NEC, and I'm calling from occupied Nipmuc and Pocumtuck territory, colonially known as Ashfield, Massachusetts. And we are so excited to have you all here today. We are thrilled that over 1,400 people registered for this event. And we've got a lot of different people in this space. We've got frontline organizers, we have union reps. We have mutual aid caregivers. We've got funders. We've got fiscal sponsors. We've got investors. We've got academics in the house. We've got artists. We've got anarchists. And we've also got social workers and socialists in the house. And we've got progressives and public health workers and political activists and so many more people. And so, as an invocation for today, we'd like to bring in the words spoken by Bernice Johnson Reagan over 40 years ago that still ring true. Coalition work is not done in your home. Some people will come to a coalition and rate its success on whether or not they feel good when they get there. And in this spirit, we welcome you to this space, which is a truly a coalitional container made up of each and every single one of us. And you're all welcome here, except for the fascists. This is a space of nuance. This is a space that will be messy. And on that note, let's jump in together. So, to kick us off today, we would like to ask you all in the chat, please share a word or a phrase that you'd use to describe what resourcing or funding has looked like for you, your community, or your organization. And knowing that all emotions, all experiences are welcome in this space. So let's just take a moment to see what folks, wow, that's a lot of stuff.
Yeah, wow. I'm seeing gaslighting, frustrating, exploitative, extractive, unreliable, scarce, wow, inconsistent, hustle, soul theft and spirit murder, antithetical, restricted, evil, competitive, rigged, inaccessible, unsustainable, and so much more. Thanks, y'all. Please keep those responses coming in the chat. So, these experiences that we're hearing from folks in the chat are unfortunately not unique, and nor are they coincidental. In fact, much of what we've all experienced in resourcing our work is by design. The past two decades have marked the rise of a new gilded age of hyperaccumulation. As you'll notice on the slides, $1.5 trillion is now hoarded by foundations, and the rise of donor-advised funds, also known as DAFs, a fiat philanthropic vehicle that has no mandatory payout timeline, has resulted in a loss of over $300 billion in donations in recent years. As our friends over at Justice Funders note in their Just Transition Investment Framework, foundations give out roughly $80 billion of grants in each year, but at the same time, contribute over 13 times that amount to extractive global stock markets. 13 times. The same irony extends to another institution that we sometimes look to for financing our movements, and that's banks. In a 2021 report, groups like our allies at the Indigenous Environmental Network share that the world's 60 largest commercial and investment banks poured a total of $3.8 trillion into fossil fuels. As Ruth Wilson Gilmore reminds us, quote, "A foundation's funds are stolen value created by working people around the world in factories, mines, and fields. The dollars that we currently rely on to finance our movements are not only greasing the wheels of Wall Street, but were actually extracted from our communities in the first place." So of course, these feelings that folks shared of things feeling extractive, feeling harmful, feeling evil, these feelings that emerge around resourcing ourselves are actually reflective of a pretty excruciatingly Sisyphean task.
And while late-stage capitalism has a particular flavor in this year, 2024, most of these issues are not new. April of this year will mark 20 years since Incite Women of Color's landmark conference, "The Revolution Will Not Be Funded," forever destabilized the terrain of how we resource our movements. This is the conference and succeeding book that put the concept of nonprofit industrial complex on the map. And Incite's own experience was colored by a 2004 incident in which the Ford Foundation retracted a $100,000 grant after catching wind of a letter that they had written in support of Palestinian solidarity and liberation. I'd like to let that sit in for a moment. They were explicitly calling for an end to genocide and occupation 20 years ago. And yet here we are, two decades later, and funders are largely still silent to this escalating genocide and collective punishment wrought on the Palestinian people, with the exception of organizing efforts like Funders for a Ceasefire Now, which is coordinating 100 plus funders into action. And it's important also to note that Incite's Palestine force is still organizing today to fight back against genocide, most recently through visionary public art actions in coordination with groups like the Palestinian Feminist Collective.
So while this conference that Zach mentioned, the anthology, and the very phrase nonprofit industrial complex often conjure images of burning our problematic nonprofits to the ground, the introduction of the book makes clear, and I quote, "The more important question is not whether one should ever get nonprofit status, but what is the most strategic way to use nonprofits so they support movements rather than being thought of as the movement. When we live in a world where nonprofits are the movement, it means that the majority of people eager to engage in the work of building solidarity economies can't, because all of the resourcing to do so is absorbed by this complex, much of which is governed by the extractive institutions like philanthropy, like banking that I mentioned earlier. All of this to say, we really need better ways of resourcing our movements. Here at NEC, we believe that the Solidarity Economy Funding Library that we're launching today is the first critical step in that direction. Not only are we hoping to illuminate funding opportunities beyond traditional philanthropy, so think non-extractive social movement investing, community-based lending, and more, but we're also of the mind that in doing so, we broaden the imaginations of both movement groups and funders for what is possible in resourcing our movements.
And for today's conversation, we have been inspired by the political framework of grassroots organization Mi Gente, in which they advocate for a threefold strategy of working within, without, and against the state to achieve their political goals. And this framing itself, internationalist note here, was inspired by a movement group in Chile called the Movimiento de Pobladores en Lucha, or MPL. And so recognizing the unique political conditions of the present moment, how can we move in deeper alignment when it comes to resourcing strategies for our movement? How do we move within, without, and against philanthropy? And so we're going to be hearing some incredible stories grounded in this framework later today. So I'll be brief, but sharing examples of what this looks like if you or your community or your organization is practicing any of these strategies, please throw an emoji or the name of your group in the chat. So let's start off with, what does it mean to work within? So an example of working within philanthropy is the field of funder organizing, which looks like treating funders as a base that can and should be organized into redistributive and reparative work. This is philanthropy grappling with the paradoxical role of working to unleash capital to those from whom wealth has been intergenerationally stolen. And there are a lot of examples of funder organizing out there. And just to highlight one, the Center for Economic Democracy organizes funders into practices like divesting from their stock portfolios and reinvesting those funds into movement-anchored work. What does it look like to organize without? An example of working without philanthropy includes self-funding our movements through the radical, simple technology of member dues. Historically and today, union members have put dues towards worker power building. One recent exciting example is the United Auto Workers announcing an investment of $40 million paid entirely by member dues that will go towards organizing workers in the non-union auto sector. And that's not even to mention mutual aid groups like the Sylvia Rivera Law Project, who in 2013 wrote this incredible report, which includes an amazing section on how groups can build out grassroots fundraising and member dues structures themselves. And then finally, an example of working against philanthropy. And I want to note that I'm not seeing enough of the against. It's interesting to see the asymmetry of the within, without. An example of the against can be found in moving policies that erode capitalist accumulation, provide immediate material relief to poor and working class people, and delegitimize the concept, the overarching narrative of big philanthropy in the first place. And an incredible example of this is the Institute for Policy Studies Gilded Giving Report, in which they call for a constellation of policies that would completely overhaul philanthropy as we know it. And finally, it's really important to note that so many of these issues are oscillating among these three strategies, right? So an example of this is the It Takes Roots Alliance organizes funders to advocate for philanthropic reform policies themselves, right? So they're hopping between that within and against. Another example, to air our dirty laundry, right? New Economy Coalition, we are funded by philanthropic institutions, we are funded by grassroots donors, and we are funded by mandatory member dues. And Insight, finally, to come back to them, is funded through grassroots donations and book sales while advocating against philanthropic accumulation.
And we're seeing so, so many more examples of all three of these strategies and a cumulative impact of those strategies in the chat. So I really encourage you to continue engaging there. And so to kind of conclude this framing that Zach and I have conceived of today, I want to center the following questions on the slide. The first is, what can we do to work in greater strategic alignment within, without, and against institutional philanthropy? And I would say more importantly, what will it take to create the conditions for a true just transition that stops the bad and builds the new and radically transforms how we currently resource our movements? I'm remembering on Monday when we were preparing for this conversation with our illustrious storytellers and the NEC team, we kind of asked everyone as a check-in, what might a fully resourced solidarity economy movement feel like? And we heard lots of responses from peaceful, a natural state of flow, money no longer being the bottleneck for the work that we do. But the most somatic response was that a fully resourced movement would feel like a deep, powerful, full-bellied inhale and exhale. So with that deep breath, let's finally share with you our Solidarity Economy Funding Library. And I'm going to invite, thanks, Zach. I'm going to invite Brel to join me in sharing this piece.
Thank you, Nairuti. And thank you, everyone who's all here. Hi, my name is Brel Hutton Opaleke. I use they and them pronouns, and I am the operations manager with Land Justice Futures. Land Justice Futures is a organization that grew out of the Nuns and Nuns movement as a partnership with Catholic sister communities in order to enact the repair, renewal, and healing work that's necessary to undo a lot of the systemic harms that were created through land extraction, especially for Indigenous and communities and Black farmers. LJF's like flagship program is a focus communities program in which we partner with sister communities and help to research and locate local partnerships for land stewardship, as well as technical service providers in order to help actually enact those land transfers. And I came into this movement resourcing project through NEC's movement resourcing group while I was North American Students of Cooperation's Director of Development Services. So still in the land focus and still working to find ways for us to ensure that land transfers to either cooperatives or land back transfers were possible for us to do from a funding perspective. And so that's kind of my connection to this program and this project starting back in 2022.
Yes. Thanks so much, Brel. And there's a lot of love for both NASCO and Land Justice Futures in the chat, which is fun to see. So just as a bit of background on this project, as Brel mentioned, they've been involved for many years now at this point in kind of addressing this need that came up through NEC membership of we need to know kind of what resourcing exists out there for our movements and then figure out a way to do that resourcing work better. And so that kind of brings us to this Solidarity Economy Funding Library. So I'm going to walk through really quickly the method, and then I'll launch the actual library here today. So the first thing is when we were kind of thinking about who do we want to include in this library, we thought really intentionally about the kinds of principles and values that we wanted to espouse. So we were really drawing on the resourcing agreements that NEC has co-created, which Brel will share about in just a moment. But we were also inspired by the work of justice funders and runway and resource generation, social movement investing principles, all sorts of different folks who've been thinking about this question of how do we better resource our movements. So that was kind of one main criterion. The second was that we really wanted to include funding entities and groups that were really taking a place-based approach to expanding solidarity movement ecosystems across the United States. And that's very in line with NEC's kind of strategic priorities of seeding these movement ecosystems in place-based ways, again, around the country. And so then we kind of thought about, okay, well, there are a lot of different ways that people can offer funding and resources. So we prioritized four different types of capital for this particular phase and launch of the library. So the first is grant-based capital. The second is non-extractive investing and investments. The third is lending. And then in partnership with another consultant and incredible colleague in the movement, Tara Mohati, we also included public dollars, a handful of place-based public dollar opportunities. We also made sure to include a wide swath of fiscal sponsors that are also included in the database in response to current movement needs that I know Brel will speak to in a little bit. And then once we kind of curated that, we just embarked on a huge desk research journey and process, which led to, you know, I think it was 800 plus funding organizations that were identified. We then kind of filtered through these categories and criteria and engaged with about 20 other movement leaders and organizations and groups across the US to give us feedback and see, you know, who did we miss? Who are folks on here that you would not include? And all this to say, that is what helped us to land on the current version of the funding library, which has about a little over 300 funders and other organizations included. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen so you're able to see the funding library. So here we are, and you'll also see a link to this webpage dropped in the chat. So this is the Solidarity Economy Funding Library. There are a series of Q&As right here on the top of the webpage that you can click through. And then as you scroll down, you'll be able to see the funding library in all of its glory. So I always find it useful to click on this little piece where it says view larger versions. So you're able to kind of see the funding library in your full screen. And I'm just going to quickly walk you through these different categories and how it can be used. And then Brell and I will walk through sort of a use case example. So right here, you have the name of the organization, followed by the URL and contact information. Many of them are email addresses. There's a few LinkedIn profiles, things like that. Under types of found organization, we have, it's almost, I want to say, 35 to 40 different types of organizations that are identified here. Again, from foundations to public dollars, so state agencies, you've got some CDFIs, credit unions, community loan funds, lots of different opportunities there. A brief description of that organization. This is a unique ad, so this is organizational affiliation. So in lieu of having some of that feedback public at this point in time, we've included two columns to serve as sort of an indicator or a nod to where this organization lies in terms of its alignments with some of these principles and things that I referenced earlier. So organizational affiliation basically means that this particular funder has engaged with a handful of different organizations in a variety of different ways. And then the other column that I just want to flag is this one called past funding. So this indicates that this organization has funded the Green New Deal Network in the past. And then the same goes for a host of other past funding things. Okay. And then that brings us to lots of different ways to filter. So you've got regions funded from national to some of these regions that are mentioned here. Focus areas that are funded, anything from climate to organizing to research to land and housing, et cetera. Communities served. So this is if a funder has indicated, you know, we're primarily interested in funding groups led by BIPOC individuals or specifically working with Native and Indigenous folks, immigrants and refugees, et cetera. And then, as I mentioned earlier, type of capital available. Now, one thing to note is that if you're on here and you're looking specifically for fiscal sponsorship, you can filter like so, and that'll give you all of the different groups that are providing fiscal sponsorship right now. And then finally, some additional information related to capital that's available. So that's anything from here's what the application process looks like, to, you know, for lenders, here are some of the rates that you'll be faced with. There's all sorts of other kind of helpful information. And then it takes it through to who is able to apply. There's, you know, several that might say 501c3, but also unincorporated orgs. So folks who are maybe working with a fiscal sponsor can be able to apply to that particular opportunity. And then finally, we've got some application deadlines and specific deadlines, all of which are in the year of 2024. And then some links to RFPs or applications or any other useful pieces of information. So let me actually ask Brell, just as a use case, is there something that you're looking for resourcing now presently? And maybe we can walk through this together.
Yeah, great. Also, Nairiti, would you be able to kind of control plus zoom in just a little bit for some of the folks who are here so they'll be able to see a little easier?
Yes, absolutely. Is this any better for folks?
I think that'll work.
Okay.
Great. So Land Justice Futures, one of the things that we do is we partner with a for-profit entity, Intermill Consulting, to do research on the land history of the folks communities that we're working with. I would like to find funding to help pay for that work.
Great. And remind me, Brell, where in the U.S. are you prioritizing this work?
Yeah, so most of our communities are in the Great Lakes area or in New England, but we do work nationally. So we're hoping to see someone in the South. So I can probably just say for now, our communities are national, Great Lakes, and Northeast.
Great. So the first thing I would suggest is filtering by focus area. And let's say land and housing as a primary focus area. And I know you referenced research, so we can also include that as well. So this will include both of these. You can filter by one and obviously have some more options pop up, but this is what it looks like. It looks like the McKnight Foundation, for example, is indeed funding in the Great Lakes region, but you also have a few other opportunities that are funding nationally, but again, have that place-based commitment that I spoke to earlier. This California one might not be as relevant for you, but it is kind of included. So you could also filter, as I mentioned, by Great Lakes and that and national. And then finally, one thing that might be really useful to you is as you're kind of looking through deadlines and things like that, you can see, okay, so it looks like McKnight has funded the Green New Deal Network in the past. So you could reach out directly to Mary Grace and say, hey, are you willing to kind of give us an introduction so that we're able to kind of reach out somewhere? And then there's also contact information available in this section, including contact emails, LinkedIn profiles, and things of the like. So that's just, again, one very clear example of how you can leverage this as a resource for the kind of funding that you're trying to engage in. So I'm going to just stop sharing. And before I pass it over to our storytellers, I just want to mention to all the folks we have on the call. So this library is open, live, and public, and ready to be used. We're also very, very eagerly requesting feedback from all users. So Belen is going to throw in a link to our Airtable form for feedback. And then there's a second form for if you have funders that you've worked with and have had a good experience, you're welcome to kind of share that as well. And then I'll just share that, you know, this is just very much a first phase of this project. NEC is really committed to seeing this through and just a few horizons in terms of where we're looking for this work. So the first one is democratizing access to some of this user feedback that we'll be getting. So, you know, if there's someone who's coming to us and saying, I had a terrible relationship with this funder and they weren't good at XYZ or the reporting requirements were totally bananas, those are things we want to be able to, of course, in anonymized ways, be able to share publicly so we can hold funders accountable. So that's one thing. The second is we're going to go back through and see what kinds of gaps there are in the funding ecosystem, whether that's by geography, by focus area, but also, you know, you'll notice that there is at this point in time an overrepresentation of grant-based capital. And so we want to be able to expand into different types of opportunities that could be available. So that could look anything like giving circles, accelerators, community savings pools, purchasing alliances, And those two last examples are from Cooperate WNC. So thanks for helping me with that. And then the last thing is being able to conduct research and be able to organize funders to be able to resource our movements better. And so if you're interested in supporting that work, this is a self-funded sort of endeavor. You're welcome to donate on the link that Belen is going to share in the chat just now. And with that, I'll conclude my portion of this conversation and bring to the spotlight or the metaphorical stage, Suparna, as well as our kind of illustrious panel of storytellers to kind of share with y'all today about what it looks like to better resource our movements. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nayurthi. Thank you, Brill. Greetings, everyone. It's an honor and a pleasure for me to be here among siblings who are fighting this good fight, getting into good trouble, and plotting revolution together. I am Suparna. I use she, they pronouns, and I offer thanks to unceded Kumayai lands as my current home, but I was born and raised in India. This home is also colonially known as San Diego in California. And I'm here wearing many witchy hats as I represent NEC as a board member, a member of NEC's movement resourcing working group that had some part to play with all of this stuff that you have seen has been presented just now by Nayurthi and Brill. And I also represent the organization for which I both work with and one that is a member organization of NEC. I am the choreographer for collective change at COFED, which is the Cooperative Food Empowerment Directive. And our mission at COFED is to transform the current extractive food and land systems into just, healed, and cared for spaces through the starting and scaling up of cooperatives led by QT BIPOC cooperators. Like NEC, COFED also exists as an intermediary. We receive philanthropic dollars, and we also serve as a grant maker through our re-granting program called CoFund or the Cooperative Fund. Our commitment to our grantees or movement partners is simple. Our liberations are deeply connected. So none of us are free until we are all free, and not just here, but around the whole world. Like many of us in this room, our work through CoFund is to dismantle systems of oppression while also co-building a liberated tomorrow that we want to live in and leave behind. We're following the leadership of Black feminists, Indigenous leaders, and disabled organizers who continuously remind us that our liberation is rooted in the deep practice of collective care and trust. And even if one non-extractive grant at a time, we are committed to returning stolen wealth and we are committed to winning. So you are about to hear from some phenomenal organizers who are already building a world in which we are winning. They are dancing to the beats of the revolution, often in spite of philanthropic constructs designed to extract their time, gifts, dignity, and care in lieu of masked attempts at uplifting our communities. The fact is, though, that the organizers you're about to hear from, and many, many of you in this call, experientially know in your bodies, and we know that funding our revolution using the same tools of colonial racist capitalism can be very tricky. But we are still out here plotting our ideal universe, being radical, or as Dr. Angela Davis says, grasping things at the root. You movement workers know that the truth in our bodies is that without communities, there is no liberation. So please join me in welcoming our community storytellers, movement weavers, revolutionaries, and please drop some love emojis and vibes in the chat for them. Welcome, Alan from Poder Emma, Tiny from Poor Magazine, Eric from the Drivers Cooperative, and our very own Sharday from NEC's Black Solidarity Economy Fund. Welcome, folks. Please soak in all the heart emojis, all the love you are receiving. I want to invite each of you into this space by telling us more about who you are, what you want the world to know about your work, and through your heart vision, what would the world look like when we win? And just as a caveat, though time is a construct, we only have so much of it today. So please take about 3 minutes to go around and share. And much to my own disdain, I will have a timer going, and you will see me looking a bit extra eager on the screen, putting up fingers, letting you know that you have 1 minute to go on your time. And then I am going to be that person who asks you lovingly to wrap up. Please accept my sincere apologies in advance. I do not like that part of this role. Okay, let's get started. First with Alan, then Tiny, then Eric, and Sharday. And then I have a couple more questions for you all. Just to repeat, who you are, what you want the world to know about your work, and through your heart vision, what would the world look like when we win? Alan, please go ahead.
Hi, everybody. My name is Alan Luis. I use they, them pronouns. I'm coming on this call from Cherokee Land in the colonial name of Asheville, North Carolina. We're in the mountains of North Carolina. And I'm a part of the Poderema team. I'm a member of our cooperative development team. And Poderema is a organization that is focusing on preventing displacement and stopping gentrification of our neighborhood here in Asheville, North Carolina. Our neighborhood is called Emma. So we are using community organizing and cooperative development to see our vision come true of stopping the displacement of the Emma neighborhood. Asheville has a huge history of displacement of Black communities, and we see our neighborhood being a target to rich developers buying up our majority mobile home park neighborhoods to displace us, to develop over us, and erase our neighborhood from the Asheville story. So I want you all to know that we are an organized community. We've been organizing in our neighborhood for almost 20 years against police license checkpoints, immigration and custom enforcement raids and checkpoints as well, and racial profiling from the Asheville Police Department to defend our community from criminalization. We are mostly working class, a migrant, recently arrived, and have migrant people who have been living here for over 20 years. So we are at risk of being displaced because most of us live in a mobile home park community, and we are made up of working class and poor people. So we are, Poderema is a part of a colaborativa, a collaboration between other grassroots organizations who share a same fiscal sponsor to focus in our fields. We have over five grassroots organizations that all have different purposes that meet the needs and are building power within our neighborhood, from language, indigenous language revitalization, to youth programming, to childcare programming. And so Poderema is one of those organizations in a collaboration and we are focusing on this issue of gentrification in the Emma neighborhood. People also need to know that our cooperatives and our communities are community governed, and we are a solidarity economy in Asheville, North Carolina. We are filled up with worker and housing cooperatives. And so together we are building up and growing our sustainability and eventually getting away from philanthropy. So that's a little bit about me, and I'm going to pass it on to the next person.
Thank you, Alan. That is so beautiful. And I would like to invite Tiny to answer the same three questions. Please tell us a little bit about yourself, what you want folks to know about your work, and what does the world look like when you're winning? Thank you.
Do you see us houseless mamas and daughters sleeping in a tent? I said, do you see us houseless mamas and daughters sleeping in a tent? That's because we don't got money for the rent. I'm a poverty scholar, that houseless mama, that houseless daughter. All those people you don't want to see, never want to be, look away from. What you going to do? Oakland, Berkeley, Frisco, New York, occupied Turtle Island, arrest we? We're in your settler colonial shit tees. I'm a poverty scholar and I rock my jailhouse attire, not because orange is the new black. Don't let Hollywood sell you that. It's because me and my po' mama did jail time for the poverty crime of being houseless in this occupied indigenous holler. Poverty scholar, the melanin challenged daughter of an Afro-Boricua mama for without whom there would be no me, a mama soltera and a welfare queen. Saying shouts out to all the relatives all across this occupied Turtle Island and all of Mama Earth and a free, free Palestine and a free, free Sudan and a free, free Turtle Island. As you are seeing on this screen, these are ancestors of the colonial settler terror lie called poverty, homelessness. That's Angeline Green Eyes, Swan, EYA. That's Ted from Black Arthur. And in the middle is a family who, after years of living in their family home, lost it behind paper lies and paper knives, as I call it. We know that our relatives become houseless for many reasons, that just because we don't have access to a roof, that doesn't somehow define our truth. I am my mama's daughter. I'm also a single mama, and when we were on the street in occupied Tovangar, AKA LA, as the settlers call it, my mama became disabled and no longer able to work, and we ended up on the street. I had to drop out of formal institutions of learning and enroll full-time in the School of Hard Knocks, which I'm honored to say I have a PhD in poverty, not because it's glamorous and not because anybody should have such a thing, but because I needed to survive. I joined thousands of other poor families as a vendador with my mama, and survival was all we could do. We had to hide on the street because as a poor family, if you're seen, your lives are criminalized. This is not about me. This is about we. My pronoun is we. Poor Magazine came from the struggle of me and Ma on the street, and it's grown into a poor people, indigenous people led movement that exists today. While we were sleeping in the backseat of a hoopty, in a doorway, in a bus bench, a shelter bed, if we're lucky enough to get one, or a motel, unbitten by that bed bug of that night, we dreamed of something we called homefulness, a homeless people solution to homelessness. That's homefulness with one L. 28 years later, and many evictions and tears, struggles and losses, because homelessness kills relatives. Homelessness kills. And more importantly, the settler colonial lie of rent and the idea that Mama Earth is for sale kills in many different ways. So 28 years later, houseless, poor, indigenous people with permission from First Nations relatives of this occupied land, which is Ohlone Lashon territory, AKA Oakland, are building and have built 12 units of rent-free forever housing. We now house 20 children, elders, mamas, disabled adults. This mama and my son are one of them. And we don't do it because of a bank loan, a philanthropimp, or a bankster, or a government nonprofiteer grant that never listens to poor people because they'd rather study us than listen to our solutions. We say solutions, not studies. No matter how many times you jail me, study me, or sweep me, it doesn't give me a home. We fund it, if you will, by an absolute solidarity economy. It's created by our solidarity family who goes to people school, if you could show the next slide. And they graduate from this 2-day session and have built this beautiful thing that we call the Bank of Community Reparations. It is not a bank. It is a sacred vessel that solves poor people's problems if we're able to raise enough. We are currently trying to help relatives in Tuvangar build another homefulness, as well as in Occupied Yalamu Frisco and in Occupied Duwamish and Suquamish territory, AKA Seattle. And as far as we're concerned, homefulness the world. Oh, Mateo.
Thank you, Tiny. You're building a world in which we are winning. Thank you.
Oh, I still have time?
We have to move to Eric, and I will come back to you with the next question. I want to give you all the time in the universe right now because it is yours already. Eric, would you like to answer these questions of who you are, what you want the world to know about yourself and your work, and what would the world look like when we win?
Thank you, Suparna, and thank you for those powerful words, Tiny. I'll introduce myself briefly. My name's Eric Foreman. I'm one of the co-founders of the Drivers Cooperative, which is a driver-owned rideshare platform operating in New York City. Also have spent a lot of time in the last few years helping a group of striking cable technicians launch a worker-owned internet service provider called People's Choice Communications, which is also operating in New York City, providing free broadband in public housing and affordable housing. And I do some other projects these days as well, working on expanding union-built affordable housing with the AFL-CIO Housing Investment Trust. But to introduce myself, my background personally is mostly in labor organizing. About 15 years ago, I started trying to unionize the coffee shop that I worked at in college, a place called Starbucks. I'm guessing people have heard of it. Maybe tragically ahead of my time, I got fired for unionizing Starbucks before it was cool, I guess you could say. But I'm very happy to say that baristas in that very same Starbucks that I was organizing successfully unionized in summer 2022, the Starbucks on the first floor of the Mall of America. So just goes to show the arc of history is in fact long. So I spent many years organizing in fast food, became a teacher, moved back to where I'm from originally, New York City. And for the past 5 years, I've been heavily focused on cooperative building worker cooperatives. So I think we'll talk, maybe we'll have time to talk more about that later in the event. But if there was something that I wanted folks here to know about my work, it's that amazing things are possible, and that movement does create alignment, and you can, even coming from nowhere. The Drivers Cooperative, we started as a group of 24 drivers in a classroom, and we were able to raise $3 million and build our own platform and launch operations and provide a decent livelihood for hundreds of drivers. You know, we're not operating at the scale of Uber, but we've got a strong start. And also, I almost forgot that maybe the most exciting thing I have to share is that, and I got 1 minute, so I'll focus on the most important thing, is that a group of drivers in Minneapolis, Minnesota reached out. Uber is threatening to leave the city because the city council is voting on an ordinance put forward by a socialist representative, Robin Wansley. Thank you very much, Robin, to impose minimum pay regulations. And so the drivers union is interested in working with us to build a driver-owned platform, and we could launch very, very rapidly. So we do need to raise money quickly. So I'm going to put a link in the chat if you want to donate. We have a fiscal sponsor that will send donations to pay for the engineering costs. It won't cost much at this point because we've been able to build so much already. I just wanted to say, one of the reasons I got interested in doing this 5 years ago was because of New Economy Coalition. Just the fact that there are people out there who believe in these visions tells you you can build the power to make it happen. And so hope to be in a position to be able to pay it forward and grow this movement. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. Sorry for being the human being that's making you go in fast motion towards the end. Appreciate you. You are winning. Sharday, tell us a little bit more about you, your work, and how you're building the world that you're winning, and what will the world look like when we win? Thank you.
Thank you, Saparna, and to all the other panelists. Like, y'all are some tough acts to follow, but I'm going to try to bring it home on this question. Hello, everyone. I'm Jardé Neighbors. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm joining you from Portland, Oregon. I have been working in participatory grant making for about 7 years now, and I'm currently the Resource Redistribution Director here at New Economy Coalition. In my role here, I steward our re-granting funds. We have two of them currently. First, we have the Black Solidarity Economy Fund, which is that lovely picture you see of the working group members at our retreat in Oakland last year. This fund was created in 2020 to support and resource Black leadership within the solidarity economy movement. And since then, we've moved about $730,000 to Black-led solidarity economy projects across the US and surrounding islands. And I think Belen can drop in a link so y'all can check out our most recent 2023 grantees. Our other fund is the Regional Relationships Fund. It's our newest resource redistribution vehicle and came from a member mandate for NEC to increase our presence as an intermediary, moving more resources to our members. The focus on this particular fund is regional organizing in the form of relationship building between members and the broader movement. So far, we've funded projects that include like conflict resolution, training, narrative building, and of course, regional gatherings. Both of these funds have member-led grant-making teams deciding where the resources will move. This is a foundational part of how we do grant-making at NEC. We see the value of self-determination and communities knowing best where resources are needed. Additionally, we see Black liberation and strong relationships as central to the solidarity economy movement. So we uplift these as part of our work. When we win, well, I'll have to find a new job. And I think a few of you might as well, because philanthropy as we know it will no longer exist. Instead of living under capitalism where wealth hoarding has created the institution of philanthropy, communities and individuals will be able to have the tools and resources needed to thrive and the ability to share those resources without repercussions. And I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Jardé. Thank you, everybody. Yes, to getting ourselves out of these jobs and then finding ways that we can resource not just ourselves, but legacies and be the kind of ancestors we want to be for the world we want to build. I feel humbled to know that I'm living in the world at the same time frame as you all are. I'm curious to hear more about the ways in which you all resource yourselves, including but also beyond monetary ways. Related to that, I'm wondering if you could share a little bit more about what are the different types of capital you need for your work and what do they allow you to do in your communities? Again, I'm going to be that person who puts up a finger when it's this finger, when it's 1 minute to go. When you have 1 minute left, please take about 3 minutes each again. This time, let's start with Jardé and then we'll go to Tiny, Eric, and then Alan.
Thanks for that. I'm glad that you added that framing around beyond monetary, because I think one of the biggest resources is people power. We need people actually doing the work, supporting the work, talking about the work, amplifying the work. Both of our member-led funding bodies are, you know, based on members volunteering to join these working groups and be in space. So it's really important. People are a very valuable resource. Monetarily, currently the Regional Relationships Fund is funded by both NEC members' dues and foundation dollars, as Zach mentioned earlier. This allows members to fund our network while deciding where those funds go. And when NEC is fundraising, talking to these philanthropic institutions, we're able to make intentional asks for foundations to earmark a certain amount of funds to go towards re-granting. And many of those are multi-year grants, which allow for the sustainability of the fund. BSEF is very similar, where we have a lot of foundation funding and a lot of grassroots individual donors as well. So no members due for BSEF this time around. We have used them in the past, but right now it's fully sustained by individual donors and foundations. What I will say about that is it's not enough. For the Black Solidarity Economy Fund, although our annual yielding is almost twice that of the Regional Relationships Fund, we never have enough. For example, in 2023, we had 78 applications and could only make 48 grants ranging for $4,000 to $7,500. So we've seen that there is a huge need for funding Black solidarity economy work and just not enough funds to make the impact that we could potentially do with this fund. So we need to increase the number of multi-year grants from bigger foundations. We only have about two foundations that give directly to BSEF, as well as increasing the number of individual donors. Last year, we got a significant number of monthly donors, which was great. You know, every penny counts. And when you have somebody who's dedicating to give on a monthly basis, it helps continue the longevity of the fund. And what's important about multi-year funding and sustainability is it gives our grantees and members something to look forward to. They know when and how they can apply for funding and when to write that into their budget as a little more guaranteed than that. Check.
Thank you, Shardy. That is so important to just lay out that it is not enough. And it is also your money. It just needs to be returned. So it is not going to be enough because a lot has been taken away. Okay, Tiny, would you like to answer this question?
Could you repeat it one more time? I'm sorry, I got lost in Sade's beautiful words.
100%, that's on me. What are the different types of capital you need for your work? Okay. And what do they allow you to do in your communities? And I'm starting the timer for 2 minutes and I'll give you a 1 minute warning with my finger. Thank you.
Well, anthropology, ethnography, psychology, the study about us, without us, our spirits, our cultures, our traditions through their lens, deconstructing our struggles while our communities are dismantled and left in rubble. I start with that piece because, as you might have imagined, I'm a poet. We say that us poor people wrote these homes with a poem. I said, we poor people wrote these homes with a poem. We're all cultural workers and houseless folks who create, but we're also storytellers, just like all of us. I'm going to shout out to any fellow poverty scholars who are on TIS today, because we have created a theory we call poverty scholarship. And it's the concept that what you've lived through is your knowledge. And it has nothing to do with the eugenicist named institutional institution. No disrespect to any academics on here. We say infiltrate to liberate. Bring poverty scholars in, bring Tiny in, and we'll teach you some real knowledge. But that said, we thanks to the folks of our solidarity family who, you know, fund the Bank of Community Reparations, we are able to pay for poor mamas who can't afford their teeth to be fixed because a healthy mouth is a wealthy mouth, relatives. State aid doesn't cover that, if you didn't know that. And so there's that. And then there's poor mama's hoopty fund because of all of our cars broke down and break down and we can't get from one place to the other. There are so many layers of unseen privilege when you have access to resources that are frightening, right? If you really think about it. What we do as poor people, as a poor people informed movement, is that we know what our relatives need, and it's a direct payment directly to folks. We are trying to build homefulness, but we can't do it without what I call bloodstained into love-stained dollars. And so what would we be doing with more resources is not having to be terrified every day that we're not going to be able to support our relatives. That's how I personally feel. Absolutely terrified. I get a call from a family who's just been evicted and all six children and elders are on the street. That's terror. So the funding and what it will allow us to do is immediately mama fest. I like to mess with the colonial language, relatives. Mama fest solutions that we are doing right now. Us folks who don't have two nickels to put together are creating and mama festing solutions. And we invite folks to join us in that. We want to build and grow our solidarity family. I don't know if somebody could put up the last slide in our last 1 minute. or less than a minute. I have no more minutes. Okay. Sorry, guys. But just so the I think there was one more, but maybe not. So we invite people to come to People School, which is always in 2 times a year. Black August is the next one. I'll stop there. Sorry.
No need to apologize. Thank you. I am mama festing time for all of us. That's what I'm trying to do over here. Thank you so much, Tiny. Eric, and then Alan. What are the different types of capital you need for your work, and what do they allow you to do in your communities? Thank you.
Thank you, Suparna. Well, I'll just in 3 minutes try to tell the story of some of the challenges of capitalizing the driver's cooperative. From incorporating the business in 2020 to raising the $200,000 or $300,000 needed to just have an initial launch took an entire year. That was a year of many of me and other folks working for no pay or low pay. That's obviously not accessible to people who are not able to survive on, you know, other part-time work or other sources of, I'm not a wealthy person. I was working as an adjunct and was able to kind of just fit this in and make it work. So fast capital would be one thing to allow new projects to get started without long incubation phases. We also had to basically, for most tech-enabled startups, and I guess you could call the Driver's Co-op a tech-enabled startup, there's a funding ecosystem they can tap into, a venture capital, where you essentially sell off the equity of the business over time. For a co-op, you don't really want to do that because the whole point is that the equity remains with the workers. And so we had to kind of construct our own sequence of funding mechanisms, starting out with sweat equity, then crowdfunding for donations. Then we were really fortunate that the co-op loan community came together. Shared Capital gave us an initial loan. The Working World stepped up, Leaf stepped up, Start.co-op stepped up. And that gave us some momentum where we were able to basically launch a membership drive, organized around 2,500 drivers, launched with a lot of attention, grateful for the focus people put on the project. And then we were able to crowdfund investment through regulation crowdfunding. Takes a huge amount of work and also regulatory compliance work to be able to do that kind of thing. Fortunately, I had set up a small nonprofit years prior to do labor education work that was able to act as a fiscal sponsor. If that hadn't been there, I don't know if we would have been able to get grants. But I would say that you need donations to get started. And on that note, is Eid Ali in the call? He was going to join, leader of the Minneapolis Uber Lyft Driver Association. We're raising money right now to help them launch. You can donate at the link in the chat. But I would say speed is important. And oh, Eid is here. Wonderful. Is there any way for Eid to say a word, or is maybe it's technically not possible? Maybe Eid, you can put a message in the chat. Very excited to help drivers in Minneapolis, St. Paul launch a driver-owned cooperative to take the place of Uber as they skip town, fleeing workers' rights. Speed is important, and flexibility is important, and patience is important with funding. This stuff is really hard. And one frustration I've had is that often the urgency and the crisis that you're experiencing every single day trying to build big things or fight big fights, philanthropy works on a different time scale. And, you know, maybe everybody has that right, but frankly, it doesn't work for us. And if we could find a way to align those things, I think we'd have stronger movements.
Thank you, Eric. And shout out to Eid in the room here. Hi, Eid. And you're absolutely right. And it is by design that we are separated the way we are. So this is one attempt of many happening right now in the world that NEC is trying to steward around joining us together in this space. Alan, to you, what are the different types of capital you need for your work, and what do they allow you to do in your communities? 2 minutes, and then I'll give you a 1 minute timer. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to echo one thing that Sharday said about multi-year funding, that we need this commitment to our communities to continue the programs and have a chance for our programs that we have to thrive, that the community relies on. Of course, we need individual donations with no ties to debt and no need to pay back. Our organizations and our community members love to participate in our work. It's changing our lives, it's changing our conditions, and we deserve to keep that programming open that wouldn't exist otherwise. And then, you know, with reliable money, we can really provide these needs to our communities. Another form of capital that we need is lending. This is what we've used. Lending coupled with support and technical assistance. We need lending that is non-extractive. And so we're really, really proud members of Seed Commons, the community wealth cooperative that we've worked together to really develop to the point that we have gotten to. Seed Commons works with its members to create sustainable business plans and has no expectation of payback until our businesses reach profitability. And that's a huge difference from the lending that happens from banks that most migrant people already cannot access. And so this type of non-extractive lending has realistic interest rates, low payments, and longer time to pay back, and really helps us in creating thriving worker cooperatives. Another example of capital that we need is non-extractive lines of credits, which is like a reliable pot of money that our community can rely on that we can always keep access to. For our neighborhood, who are all working class, migrant, and mobile home park communities, the type of lending that comes from lines of credits really provides us the opportunity to transform our conditions in that moment so that someone who has a hole in their floor or a leaking roof doesn't have to wait to change their lives. And it's also encouraging them to be an active member of our community versus hiding in the shadows of slumlords. And so we don't want to drown our communities in debt. And so these types of lending that we get from Seed Commons and other ways is the ways that we can really successfully convert mobile home parks into resident-owned cooperatives and keep these properties outside of the speculative market, which is our biggest threat, is gentrification. So keeping these properties outside of the speculative market and keeping them in the use of the community, which was the way we like it. This type of non-extractive lending gives us time and also the trust to ensure that our project can be successful. So like our neighborhood has no park here. We had no green space, no park to turn up at, to have birthday parties at. And so, zoning, permitting, city, county, these things take so much time. And so they're not easy systems to work with either, but the type of lending that we have access to has really allowed us to work our plan that we created. And if needed to pivot, we can pivot. You know, Seed Commons is an amazing cooperative that has given us this chance. And so as of now, none of our cooperatives have defaulted on a payment because we have that trust, because we have that technical assistance and support. So overall, Seed Commons and our work as organizers have set up our community for success. Our members have the dignity to pay back, to work in dignified jobs, to have permanent safe housing, and now that our labor, and just really know that our labor is healing us through changing our conditions. Thank you. That's what I wanted to share.
Thank you, Alan. Just soaking all of this wisdom in. I hope you're seeing the chat once in a while just to see the love and all of the affirmations you all are receiving. So folks, as we wrap up this section of our time together, I want to invite you all to share your insights on one more idea. There are some funders on this call and many more out there to whom we hope your message will, to whom we hope your messages will get through to the phoenixes of the Zoom recordings. So in that spirit, I ask you, what do you want folks with resources to know about your work? And shout out to Tiny for a reframe on this question. What do you want folks with resources to know about your work, your pathway for revolution, and how they can work with you rather than against you? Again, this is a wrap up. We only have about 12 more minutes left on the entire time together. So if you could take about 2.5 minutes each on this section, and then we'll wrap it up and hand it over to the next section for closing. This time, let's start with Tiny, and then Alan, and then Sharday, and then we'll wrap up with you, Eric, if you could close us out. Thank you. And I'm putting the question in the chat as well, so you can see it. Thank you.
First of all, we've all been lied to in capitalism. I want to say that. I want to say this is a calling in, not a calling out. That us poor people, our mamas and our grandpapas, our tías, our tíos, abuelitas, abuelitos, are always hiding and shame, filled with shame because we didn't make it in this capitalist settler colonial lie of Americland. I want to say that people lose their lives crossing false borders and accumulating and struggling their whole life in poverty, but that people with resources are also lied to. And it's a very important recognition that we are all suffering from this disease of capitalism. So again, I say it's a calling in, not a calling out to folks with resources. Again, another shout out for People School Degentrification Decolonization Seminar. And so much love to you, Alan, and all the work y'all are doing out there. I got to come visit. But for real, it really is about helping us heal from these settler colonial lies. And I hate to break it to your family, but you don't unhinge and unlink from a lie that you've been told for 530 Gregorian years overnight. So I want to throw love on you and slather you in love notes that this decolonization, degentrifucking process is a life process. And that we just hope to start that in our 2-day seminar. But the other piece around that is that without each other, without housed and unhoused people, without gentrifucked and gentrifiers, without capitalists and decapitalists actually coming together, we cannot unhinge this lie of hoarding and accumulating and stealing and occupying. And so again, I want to call in, not call out, and I want to say that the love goes both ways and the shame goes both ways. And that a lot of times people with resources are in movements and they're hiding. They're hiding what they have because of that shame. And so I want to encourage you to do that healing work, whether it be with us or with yourself, because that those spaces of shame have to stop so that we can actually together heal Mama Earth, who is hurting, and all of our relatives and our babies. Oh, oh my Deo. Follow Poor Magazine on InstaScam and Facecrack and Twitter and X and all that ish. You know, it's currency. Hey.
Hey, thank you, Tiny. I wish that I could convert myself into a fire emoji, but everything you're saying is pure fire. Alan, what do you want folks with resources to know about your work, your pathway for revolution, and how can they work with you rather than against you?
Okay. So I want folks to know, funders to know, people with resources, that we are building self-sustaining cooperatives in our ecosystem. We have permanently protected over 60 units of housing for ourselves and future generations. And also that we're building dignified jobs, places where people love to work. And so this is like just a peek into the future of where we're headed, right? Building up the future that we need for ourselves, for the people who have been systemically taken apart of the, removed from the care or from the systems that support people meeting their needs. And so we're building up professionals, we're building up skills in our community, training each other, and we are the people who are directly impacted that are doing this. So we trust within ourselves, our own neighbors, our own people to build successful cooperatives and build the services that we need in our neighborhood. We have a bookkeeping cooperative, a preschool, a translation and interpretation cooperative, who I wish were here, and a property management cooperative that supports our housing cooperatives. And so I just want you all to know that we need to get creative in our budgets and really start thinking about what are our earned income strategies ourselves beyond philanthropy. And that's all I want to share right now.
Healing and dignified work. I'm hearing that a lot. All right, this time, Shardae, and then we'll hand it over to Eric to close us off. Thank you.
Okay. Like I said earlier, we need more folks willing to unapologetically fund Black-led work at all times, regardless of what your focus area is, be it climate justice, reproductive justice, disability justice, whatever it is. Black folks are feeling the impacts and working for solutions in their community, likely with less resources than are needed. So give to Black folks, and not just the legitimized organizations that have become watered down and palatable to the dominant culture. Fund queer Black folks, fund Black sex workers, fund Black children, fund Black folks who are incarcerated, who are disabled, who are immigrants. Fund the work of Black liberation, and I promise collective liberation will be your thanks. We are actually currently in the middle of raising funds for a Black radical democracy convening that'll be led by our Black Solidarity Economy Fund working group. We're going to be bringing together members, grantees, and other movement partners in Durham, North Carolina in July. Here is a direct link for folks to donate if you are interested. And if you're interested in hearing more about NEC's regranting vehicles, we'll be hosting a funder briefing in late August. Everyone that's on this call will be getting information once we have registration links and all that available as well. And I'll leave it there, pass it off to you.
Thank you for sparing me the shame of putting a finger up. I appreciate it. Eric, please close us off on this section. What do you want folks with resources to know about your work, your pathway for revolution, and how can they work with you rather than against you?
Well, I think in these conversations about resources, personally, I always find it easiest to talk about the lack and the fact that there's just not enough, because that's true. Even with the resources we've gotten, it's not enough. And so, you know, our reality is characterized by bootstrapping, by having to make trade-offs, and frankly, with people getting burned out because people are, you know, overworked, trying to do what we're doing with the resources we've got. But I want to leave that aside for a moment and talk about the glass half full's perspective, which is gratitude, and gratitude for the support that we have gotten. And just to call out a few names, very grateful for the support of One Project, of Shared Capital Cooperative, of LEAF, the Working World, New Economy Coalition for Amplifying, and for over 1,000 individuals and other organizations who invested and donated so that the Drivers Cooperative could exist. What I think I want people to know is that those resources were well spent. They were an investment, and it's an investment that, in my opinion, has generated incredible returns and can also deliver so much more. We built an organization of over 10,000 drivers in New York City, which has changed the conversation about the gig economy. It has become a political force for the solidarity economy locally. We have legislation at the state and the city that sponsored for a Green New Deal for rideshare in the gig economy. We built technology, which we can easily make available for any group of drivers and allies worldwide to replicate this. We're basically able to open an entirely new lane for the cooperative movement. And that's because of the work that so many people put in, much of which has not been paid or been very underpaid, but it's also because of the resources that others have provided us with. And so personally, I'm very grateful for that. And I think what I'd like folks to know is that this investment, it's not charity, it's an investment. It's an investment in system change. And frankly, it's the highest and best use of funds that you can make. And with more resources, we've done a lot, I think, with relatively small resources, although it's been significant. And with more, we can do much, much more. So feel very grateful to be building this movement together with everybody here.
That's my timer. That was very seamless. Thank you. I don't have any idea how to even end this session. I appreciate you all so much. Someone in the chat called you dream reality storytellers. I think that is very appropriate. You are telling the stories of what is not just happening, but what is possible. Building a world we have not seen makes you revolutionary world builders. And there are so many other folks on this call who are also doing that. So shout out to all of you. And just to summarize this section and then hand it over to Brill, who is going to maybe lift up some stuff that's come up in the chat, but I also know we have only 2 minutes left on this time, that when we invest in humans, we invest in our planet, we invest in each other, we will not be free until we are all free. Thank you for giving us your space and your time and for allowing me to hold your stories. I'm handing it over to Brill. Much gratitude.
Thank you so much, Suparna. So as we're coming right here to time, just wanted to very quickly wrap up and note the resourcing agreements that are the basis of the funding library. So I do encourage folks to read through those resourcing agreements that are down there. Each one of the columns that are in our funding library are really based out of these, especially if you look at slide 4 there, it gives you the purpose of what this resourcing agreement is. And then I'll just hand it off to Sharday for time.
Thanks so much, bro, and for being like an awesome part of the Movement Resourcing Working Group that helped push like all of this work forward. Here are just a couple of calls to action. You know, take what you want, leave what you don't. Please review and consider adopting the resourcing agreements that Brell just shared. Share your feedback and get activated with us using the Airtable form. They were dropped when we were talking about the funding library. They will be included in all of the follow-up as well. Help spread the word about the Solidarity Economy Funding Library on your website, whether it's via blog post, social media, newsletter. We have a toolkit that we'll provide to help y'all share the information as well. Donate, donate, donate. This whole thing is about moving resources, y'all. So continue to help us make this resource available to folks in the public. And if you're interested in joining NEC, you can fill out a member interest form. The link is also provided. Thank y'all so, so much for joining. This was such an awesome space to be in. So many amazing people speaking and sharing gems in the chat. Really, really appreciate y'all.